I'm Dr. Jody Cairns. I'm the director of the Institute for Human Science and Culture, which is this beautiful space where we're sitting right now. And I'd like to start today with the university's land acknowledgement. The University of Akron is located on lands that have been home to many diverse nations, including the Ohio Seneca, Cayuga, the Lenni, Lenape, the Miami, the Shawnee, the Wyandot, the Ottawa, and the Ojibwe nations. These lands were ceded in the 1805 Treaty of Fort Industry and forced removal of tribes through the Indian Removal Act of 1830. The University of Akron pays respect to the land and the lives of Indigenous nations past and present, and is committed to a process of continual learning, reflection, and reconciliation. We in the Cumming Center for the History of Psychology broadly and the Institute for Human Science and Culture specifically honor the land and lives of indigenous nations past and present, and aim to use our facilities and collections, especially our collections of ancestral belongings, to educate, uplift, to provide space and audience, and to amplify voices, art, knowledge, and the cultural experiences of indigenous people. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Dane Quinn, who is a professor of engineering at the University of Akron campus, to introduce our speaker.
Thank you. It's my great honor to introduce to you Dr. Malinda Maynor Lowery. She is currently the Cahoon Family Professor of American History at Emory University and Director of the Native American and Indigenous Studies Center. There, of which she tells me she's the founding member
and only,
and currently the only member as they look to expand. Malinda, as I so well know her, is a Lumbee Indian and wears many hats. Obviously, she is a professor at Emory University. Prior to that, she moved from UNC-Chapel Hill in 2021. She was at UNC for 12 years. Prior to that, she was at Harvard University for 4 years, where she actually got her undergraduate degree in 1995, and eventually her PhD in 2005 from UNC. Between that period of time, she wore other hats. She is a documentary filmmaker. She graduated from Stanford University in their film, Masters of Arts film program, I believe in, 1997. Thanks. So she had worked on a number of documentary films between her MA and beginning her PhD program. And her film career continues. She currently screened her most recent film, Lumbee Land, for students here at the University of Akron. Earlier today, I think it was a great success. And she also wears other hats. Her beautiful daughter, Lydia, is here with us today. She is the mother to a wonderful human being, probably the oldest, most mature person in the room. And then for me personally, her additional hats are as my sister. So normally, I would ask an individual that I'm introducing, hey, tell me a little bit, something that I could share with the audience. She said, why don't you tell an embarrassing story? I said, I don't really know any embarrassing stories because to the best of my knowledge, Melinda's never done anything embarrassing. We may have some family members watching online and they might be able to chime in later with an actual embarrassing story. But then she said, well, let's tell the embarrassing story that we have together, which, once she graduated from Harvard, I drove her back to North Carolina, where she grew up. And on the way back, managed to run out of gas in the middle of a deserted field in just across the border of North Carolina at 11:30 p.m. So we managed to pull off the interstate. We managed to run out of gas right in front of the house of a lovely woman who had a spare tank of gas, right? Gave us our gas, got us on our way. And that, Melinda tells me, is the only time she's run out of gas. It is not the only time I run out of gas. So most of this is, I guess, an embarrassing story about me. But it is definitely one that we share, and we share many things, and I can't tell you how incredibly proud I am and how wonderful it is to have her at the University of Akron to talk to us about Native American women in history. So with that,
thank you.
Dr. Maynor Lowery.
And you can ask me afterwards about it, more embarrassing stories. There's plenty. but I'm so, so grateful to Dane for kind of initiating this particular conversation, for Jody and Kathy and others here at the center, at the Institute and Museum for following through, and just, anyway, giving me such a, and Lydia, such a warm, warm welcome. Thank you all very much. It's really felt wonderful to be here. So I'm going to not trip on a cord and begin by kind of going back to those college days, actually. And when I was in college, the world learned of Laurel Thatcher Ulrich's famous quote, "Well-behaved women seldom make history." It might be one of the original forms of social media, actually, because it kind of went viral, you know, before that meant anything other than the spread of a disease. Like millions of other women, I found myself motivated, excited by this idea, and inspired. And I myself was making my own kind of history at that time. I was the second member of the Lumbee tribe to attend Harvard University, which was 692 miles exactly from my home in North Carolina. I was also the first Lumbee woman. I became the first Lumbee to graduate from Harvard, and my younger brother, our brother Ben, became the second. 15 years later, I joined Laurel as her colleague in the history department at Harvard, and again, I was making history with my friend, Abenaki scholar Lisa Brooks. We were the first two Native women appointed to permanent tenure track positions at the school. So I never stopped to think about what all of these firsts might mean, because making history didn't really motivate me. I was never encouraged to stand out, but always to fulfill my core responsibilities as a Lumbee daughter, a sister, and a niece, and an aunt. And at heart, I was simply a good Lumbee girl. And in the eyes of my family, especially my parents, bad behavior made you a target. My presence in the historical record meant little if getting there meant that I was to become a victim of the police or of the courts or that any person with more power than I had. I wanted to please my parents, of course. I didn't want them to upset them. And for them, the absolute best situation was for me to completely blend in. Years, years, years later, when my sister-in-law told my father, "You'd never know she went to Harvard," both he and I considered that one of the highest compliments I've ever received. The point of my upbringing as a Lumbee woman was to not stand out, but it took some time for me to understand how that instruction could coexist with the expectations of what I understood to be feminism. Around that same time, in 1991, legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw's concept of intersectionality began to take hold in scholarly circles. It has received much less attention than Laurel Ulrich's meme-worthy quote, but it explains my experience much better. Generally speaking, Crenshaw began by trying to articulate the experience of Black women. Intersectionality is a concept that addresses the multiple and overlapping layers of oppression that people experience, including gender, race, ability, sexual orientation, socioeconomic standing, immigrant status, and more. Even as a college student, I observed that white women did not all experience the same pressure I did to behave well and blend in. To be sure, they had high expectations and pressures that they felt they had to achieve. But in the early 1990s, most of the white 18 to 22-year-olds I knew didn't worry about whether their bad behavior would wind up on their permanent record, get them killed, or get someone they love killed. I'm more like what Black feminist Roxane Gay calls a bad feminist, but a good woman. Laurel Ulrich's phrase has been embraced, and like most ideas, once people start to run with it, it becomes detached from its original meaning. As it's been repeated on t-shirts, mugs, and bumper stickers, it presumes that well-behaved women don't make a fuss, that well-behaved women don't make a mess. In our Lumbee dialect, instead of making a fuss, we say, cut the fool. If my mother, who I think is watching, hi mom, If my mother ever said, quit cutting the fool, she had already gone one step beyond the threshold of impatience, and you'd better shut up or your day was going to get a lot worse. I didn't know until I spent years researching Lumbee people in the documentary record that beneath my mother's instruction, loving instruction, lay hundreds of generations of experience and about 20 generations of adapting to colonialism. Beneath that instruction to behave, to appear docile, was also the instruction to make something out of myself, as my father said. Through their example, I internalized that making something out of myself actually meant making the best. Be the best at whatever I did, and that would disrupt the intersecting systems of white supremacy, patriarchy, and capitalism that had made good behavior a survival tactic for men and women in my family. Being the best meant safety. Anything less was unsafe. And still, making history stayed with me, so much so that I became a historian because I wanted to see more people like me in history. Laurel Ulrich articulated the idea from the exact same motivation. What kind of women do we find in the historical record? What does it mean to make history? Much of what American historians write about is drawn from sources, of course, created by men. The phrase contains an instructive, if very generalized, concept. Well-behaved women go largely unnoticed if we look only at sources created by men. The speeches, newspaper articles, diaries, account books, letters, and so much more that make it into archives. Many sources only make note of women when the men who create the sources notice women doing something they don't approve of. Much of United States history, even history that centers women, is written without questioning the inferior status to which women have been relegated. Even the histories of women resisting inferiority begin from a status quo that presumes women's second-class position. So in this kind of society, women must misbehave. They must assert themselves. They must make a fuss or make a mess in order to appear in the historical record. Over the decades of diving into Native American history, however, especially here in the Southeast where I live, one cannot avoid a very simple but profound truth. Not every kind of society regards women as inferior. Native societies, in fact, in the Southeast, have afforded women inherent worth and power, as well as authority to make decisions about themselves and their communities, including decisions about men. There is a way to make history beyond being well-behaved or badly behaved. One can simply be in charge. Yet the source material on which we make history, that is to say, we create an interpretation of the past, still tends to describe women according to the standards of male observers. Today, I want to focus on how we locate Native women, and especially Lumbee women, in historical source material that mentions us only when we are behaving badly or acting in a way to catch the narrow attention of the mostly European men who are creating the sources. My goal here today is to address the question, how do we make history? In one sense, making history concerns how we create interpretations of the past. What kinds of sources must we use, and how do we read them? In another sense, making history concerns our life purpose, the legacy we inherit from our ancestors, and the legacy we leave our descendants. How do we create that legacy, and what evidence of it do we leave behind? So I'm going to toggle back and forth a little bit between sources that are created by European observers that describe individual Native women and sources that provide context to those observations. And together, these two types of sources make us question the portrayal of women and the society from which these women came. I'm going to start with an example of a Seminole woman, because this is a relatively straightforward example of how to read a historical source created by a European man about a Native woman. Unnamed in this historical narrative, this woman attracted the attention of 18th century surveyor and botanist William Bartram because she behaved badly, in his view. Traveling through Florida in the 1790s, Bartram spent a little time with a Seminole community and relayed a story of a woman and her husband. In relating the husband's history, Bartram wrote that he is, as he said, a stout, genteel, well-bred man, active and of a heroic and amiable disposition, and by his industry, honesty, and engaging manners, had gained the affections of the Indians, and soon made a little fortune by trade with the Seminoles. The man married a Seminole woman, which was common when a European man wanted to engage in trade with a southeastern native community. Bartram continued, "He loves her sincerely, as she possesses every perfection in her person to render a man happy. Her features are beautiful and manners engaging. Innocence, modesty, and love appear to a stranger in every action and movement." Sounds like a Pride and Prejudice or something like that. It's about the same time period. Clearly, Bartram found her attractive and might have been envious of the man, but he went on to describe the trader as a beguiled and vanquished lover and an unhappy slave. His wife has already drained him of all his possessions, which she dishonestly distributes among her savage relations. Bartram describes her as a sneaky spendthrift, freely redistributing her husband's property to her undeserving family. Bartram wrote of the white man, "He is now poor, emaciated, and half distracted, often threatening to shoot her, and afterwards put an end to his own life. Yet he has not resolution even to leave her, but now endeavors to drown and forget his sorrows in deep draughts of brandy." By emphasizing the man's suffering and improper treatment, Bartram makes violence against this Seminole woman seem justified. There is more. Bartram writes about how the woman's own male relatives, notably her father, but also other female relatives, condemn her behavior. Students of Southeastern Native history can immediately spot the distortions in Bartram's tale of this unhappy couple. What Bartram does not mention in his text, and may have utterly failed to recognize, is that men in the Seminole community were not likely considered owners of domestic property or the produce from Seminole gardens and fields. Women were heads of households, and according to Seminole law, were in charge of distributing household goods to their families as they saw fit. Women gained this authority because every Seminole person derived their community membership from a woman, specifically their mother. Membership in a mother's clan connected a Seminole person to an ancient line of ancestors and provided a clear sense of roles and responsibilities in the community. Fathers typically had, in fact, little authority over a woman's or a man's socialization and upbringing, meaning that if this woman's father disapproved, it probably didn't matter very much. If her mother or her mother's sisters and brothers disapproved, that would be much more consequential. Based on Seminole's own ways of understanding women's roles, the woman Bartram encountered would have been merely exercising her rights as the head of household. Assuming her relatives were in fact disapproving because it was her husband threatened her, abused alcohol, and let the family go without food. He certainly did not fulfill his role in the way a Seminole community expected. I want to mention one other aspect of this source which can help us understand how to read European-made source materials about Native women. Bartram takes care to explain that he relates this information, quote, "so foreign to my business," it's like, not my business, but I'm talking about it anyway, in order to demonstrate that he believes that labeling Seminoles as untutored savages, which many other European people at this time were doing, does their actual virtue and honor an injustice. He wrote, "for these people are both well-tutored and civil." He uses this story of an unhappy couple to elevate himself and his superior opinions well beyond the scope of his expertise in botany. He wrote, "It is from the most delicate sense of the honor and reputation of their tribes and families that their laws and customs receive their force and energy." Even in a culture with which he has little to no familiarity, Bartram is confident that all Seminoles agree on his definitions of honor and virtue, definitions which cast women as subservient to their husbands rather than independent household managers. If we understood all women through lenses like Bartram's, we would not be able to recognize ourselves as women today, as independent managers and providers in the professional sphere and the domestic sphere. Leaning on Bartram's analysis without the crucial context provided by knowledge of Native gender roles and cultural expectations is also just bad history. History has consequences. Getting it wrong, especially refusing to see multiple perspectives, shapes what we believe is possible in the present day. This example from the Seminole community of Florida is but one of many in the documentary record where outsiders judge Native women according to the standards of their own society rather than of Native societies. Outsiders' impressions of Native women often yield a distorted picture of them and of the Native communities to which these women belonged. To understand the world of women themselves, historians must tackle different kinds of sources, and in them we see women not merely as servants of men, but as nurturers of whole societies. As historians, we can't afford to make the same mistakes that Bartram does. There is too much at stake when history is misunderstood. Instead, we must devote our studies to understanding Native women on the terms that Native women understood themselves. So, follow me down the rabbit hole. And this is the rabbit hole of Lumbee genealogy. But I promise I'm not going to let you go far astray. But every time you begin to talk about, especially the Lumbee community, but many other Native communities, you start to look at family relationships. And you start to look pretty deeply at how people are related to one another. And it so happens that census records and genealogical, other kinds of genealogical records are the best ways to find women in the sources, because those aforementioned journals, newspaper articles, you know, manuscript documents don't often mention women, but they're everywhere when you start to look at genealogy. And these family relationships are also the primary way that we know ourselves in the Lumbee community. I can say more of that later if you'd like, but. At around the same time that Bartram recorded this perception of Seminole womanhood in Florida, Lumbee women in North Carolina were also managing the changes brought by outsiders to their communities. When we see these women through the sources where they are most often mentioned directly or by name, including court records and newspapers, a certain picture emerges. We find Lumbee women in court records because they had been accused of breaking the law. Often their so-called criminal behavior was actually quite rational economic behavior necessary for self-preservation that became criminalized. For example, in the decades after the American Revolution, Lumbee women were frequently accused of trading with enslaved people, an act that was illegal for all free people in North Carolina, regardless of their race. A Lumbee woman named Mary Cumbo, here over there in pink, and her daughter Elizabeth were arrested several times in the 1820s and the 1830s for illegally trading with enslaved people. On one instance, for bartering with a man named Ralph. Ralph provided them with corn in exchange for cloth. With the frequency with which Lumbee women appeared in court, we should ask why, rather than simply conclude that Lumbee women were criminals. A bit of interrogation, kind of like what we conducted with William Bartram's writings, complicates this picture. Lumbee women grew their own corn and other vegetables, and at this time, these women most likely lived among their relatives as part of a large family of landowners. So we can assume that acquiring corn from an enslaved person had a rational economic purpose. They weren't just breaking the law because they were too lazy to grow their own corn. Why then did Mary and Elizabeth Cumbo need to barter for it? Had a drought or some other disaster prevented them from having enough to eat? That's possible. But assuming Ralph was enslaved in the same area, an event like that would have also affected the corn crop of the farm where he was enslaved. If disaster struck the corn crop, it's unlikely that Ralph would have been able to take a surplus of corn to barter. If they didn't need the corn to eat, if Mary and Elizabeth didn't need the corn to eat, why else would they trade for it? We also know from the same court records that Lumbee men were charged with illegally trading liquor with enslaved people. Given that kind of additional evidence, I speculate that Mary and Elizabeth ran another business, moonshining, and they secured additional corn to turn into whiskey. Making and selling moonshine was legal for free people of color in North Carolina when Mary and Elizabeth were arrested for bartering with Ralph. It was trading with the enslaved person that was illegal. In 1845, the state legislature outlawed free Native and Black people's ability to make and sell whiskey altogether, giving whites an exclusive monopoly over the trade. Here we see a clear example of how when Native women engaged in activities that supported their families, they were criminalized for doing so, while the white population was free to profit from the same activity. Without this kind of additional context, the court records alone fail to tell the whole truth. We can continue this interrogation exercise on another popular historical source, which includes newspaper records. The one 19th century Lumbee woman who became well known to non-natives was Rhoda Strong Lowery. When Rhoda was 10 or 11, the Civil War erupted, and by the end of the war, at age 15 or 16, she was a legendary beauty in the eyes of both whites and Indians. Rhoda's somewhat typical upbringing took a decided turn when she married Henry Barry Lowery. Her marriage took place at the end of the Civil War and the beginning of the so-called Lowery War, in which Henry Barry, his maternal relatives, meaning his mother's nephews, his cousins on his mother's side, and his brothers, as well as Rhoda's brothers, along with some of his Black and white neighbors, took up an armed resistance against conservative Democrats trying to regain power after the Civil War. Still today, Henry Barry Lowery holds the highest uncollected bounty on any individual in North Carolina's history, except for Jefferson Davis, the president of the Confederacy. The stakes were very high for Rhoda. And because her husband was so notorious and generally hated by white observers, it is difficult to distinguish fiction from fact in Rhoda's story. The more one tries to uncover a truth, the more truth itself seems to recede into ambiguities that figure Rhoda as an example of Lumbee womanhood, but not a positive one, at least not according to the standards held by white men and women. A New York journalist traveled south in the 1870s to report on Henry Barry Lowery's uprising. He wrote that whites called Rhoda the, quote, Queen of Scuffletown. Scuffletown was a white name for the Lumbee settlement in North Carolina, a name that implied a rough and tumble, violent community. In using the word queen, they employed the lowest form of insult by openly mocking her with a title she clearly could never possess. By making her queen of a place they feared and detested, added injury to the insult. Furthermore, some whites attested that Rhoda was not a, quote, constant wife, but followed the current example of Scuffletown, meaning that neither she nor many Indian women remained faithful to their husbands. The journalist followed this statement by simply saying dismissively, other persons deny this. The journalist also wrote that Rhoda was the most beautiful mulatto of Scuffletown. He wrote, she appeared to be a meek, pretty-eyed, rather shrinking girl of a very light color and poorly dressed. Hardly someone who carried herself as a queen, he might have continued, though he knew that moniker to be a jest at her expense. Instead, he offered her as a commoner, meek, shrinking, but pretty-eyed and of light color, no doubt pleasing attributes to many men. The label he chose to characterize her, mulatto, is now outdated, but was common in the 1800s, used to describe a person of mixed race, typically African-American and white. Observers of the Lumbee community, including African-American author Charles Chestnut, used this term to describe Native people in eastern North Carolina generally, not just Rhoda herself. All of these labels obscure Rhoda as a Lumbee woman, making accurate and well-rounded descriptions of Native women even harder to find in the historical record. This newspaper account is one of the fullest we have about Rhoda, and the journalist leaves the impression that she fits the stereotype of a Jezebel at best or a deviant at worst. But to what moral and social standard are we comparing her? Assuming some of the journalist's observations are true, or that he was at least truthfully recording the white and black community's impressions of her, There is another set of information to glean from this source when we add context to it. Lumbee oral histories about Rhoda are necessary if we are to gain a fuller picture of her life and the times in which she lived. Lumbees promote Rhoda's exploits right beside Henry Berry's. She joined him in his fight. The day of their wedding, December 7, 1865, authorities arrested Henry Berry and put him in jail in the town of Whiteville, about 30 miles away from their home place. The police believed that the jail was impenetrable, but Lumbee oral tradition recounts how Rhoda penetrated it by baking a cake with a file in it, or a knife, some stories differ, and taking it to the jail herself, and Henry Berry quickly escaped. On another occasion, she walked 80 miles to help his comrades escape from prison in Wilmington. The legend here differs between that told by Native people and that told by outsiders. Lumbees remember that she used the old cake trick, and that the jailers allowed Henry Berry's gang members to have the cake and the pistol this time that was concealed inside of it. A heavy cake. Can you really imagine a pistol in a cake? Somebody would have picked up on that, but whatever. Outsiders, however, tell this elaborate tale, actually, of this incident. Talk about Rhoda arriving in Wilmington, securing intelligence about the whereabouts of her husband's friends by working as a maid at a local inn, and then pretending to seduce the jailer and beat him over the head with a lead pipe. She then stole his keys and unlocked their cell. I think the gun story kind of makes more sense, but the Lumbee story is at least a more straightforward tale of a woman using domestic arts to further their cause, while the outsider version has Rhoda using seduction, brute strength, and extraordinary cunning to assist. Each reflects what the storytellers believed about Lumbee women. Other pieces of the historical record add even more complexity to Rhoda's story. She bore three children during her six-year marriage to Henry. Their names were Polly, Maggie, and Delaware. She harbored gang members and supplied them with provisions. In 1872, Henry Berry disappeared, whether by accidentally shooting himself while cleaning his guns or by actually escaping, we are not sure. And from that point, Rhoda lived on her own and provided for her children. By 1897, 24 years later, she had hit upon a profitable trade, bootlegging. Like Mary and Elizabeth Cumbo 70 years earlier, she was arrested. Federal agents arrested 48-year-old Rhoda for selling liquor without a license, and the U.S. District Court tried and convicted her. She spent 60 days in the Robeson County Jail for this crime, possibly the same jail from which she had helped Henry escape. One of her daughters, Maggie, was also arrested for trading liquor illegally. Other than being in business together, these newspaper reports give us little insight on Maggie's and Rhoda's relationship. It might seem surprising that women in the late 19th century could or would form a mother-daughter bootlegging operation, but we don't have to look far to understand what kind of women they were. We just need to look at something completely different, a quilt. So I'm going to bear with me with a little technical moment, because I want folks to watch a little bit of a video with this particular lady, Miss Emily Locklear. Miss Emma is a treasure of our community. I have to just get the video 1 second, sorry. Here we go. Now, this is a video recorded by the Museum of the Southeastern Indian at the University of North Carolina at Pembroke. If you ever are driving to Myrtle Beach, it's definitely like worth your time to stop there and visit. This is, Miss Emily is sort of Maggie's stepdaughter. It's like a long story, but she tells this some wonderful, wonderful stories about Maggie. So I'm going to let you listen to a few. This is Rhoda's daughter that she's talking about.
And it was not unusual. My Aunt Anna said for Maggie to dance out a pair of shoes at one of those wood cuttings. That she was light on her feet, very active and was just a doll out on the yard. A wood cutting is where families go into the woods and just trim up a tree and bring trees there, and they would cut up all night long. They played music, they had, instruments that they played, and they just danced and had a good time. Cut wood. I would like them to take away her tenacity to work, not only in the house, but in the field, and yet had time to put that quilt together. When my father died, he gave it and left it with my mother, Leola Locklear, and she treasured it because he had explained to my mother about her working on that quilt. And I'm almost of the opinion that she undoubtedly got the material through her three husbands, because it is made of dress material and the little pine cone patches, as well as pants. So how she cut all that material and then put it together, there was no sewing machines in those days. And each piece had to be ironed and placed together for that quilt. I think it got its reputation from the uniqueness of how she put those little pieces of material in that quilt. Each patch has 2,001 plus little pieces of material. Now, some people have tried making that quilt and have been successful. There have not been many, but for some that I know, you had to take those materials, cut them, iron the pieces down, and then try to get them under. And I've never seen of those that have been made the unique way that Maggie put her patches together. When I look at it, and I'm not a seamstress, I don't even sew, but I admire how she put it together, and the time, and it was something that she was making and leaving for her people. Once people saw it, knew the quilt was here, I came in and barred it, handled it, counted the pieces, something that had never been done at a house. I mean, it was really an early. This is my way of trying to tell people about the work that Maggie put in it. And that I am just beyond words when it comes to the idea that it's a symbol now for our people. I knew it was special even as a little girl.
Okay, I'm gonna stop there and ask us to go back here for a moment. Sorry, y'all. I'm like blind. I'm at that stage in my life where you can't see close, you can't see far away. Oh, let me get over here and cut my window off. There. Okay. So Miss Emily tells, this completely different picture of Maggie Lowery than is left behind in the documentary record about her. This extraordinary heirloom, this quilt, and believe me, you should go see it, especially if you're like even a little bit of a quilt fanatic. It's stunning. It's large, these 2,000 piece patches on it. It's a testament to a life, but also to the art and the work of women, and also to Maggie's mother, Rhoda, and to their family's sacrifice. Miss Emily talked about Maggie's work ethic and her tenacity, her ditching, her clearing land, the farming, the cooking, the sewing, the dancing. You know, none of this information is made available to us from journalists who cared only for Rhoda's looks or for her behavior. Miss Emily mentions the pine cone patchwork is now a symbol for our people. It's a visual representation of all of our land and of our tenacity of Lumbee women everywhere. And it's something that Lumbee women wear proudly. Here you see Miss Lumbee, Teen Miss Lumbee, Junior Miss Lumbee, and Little Miss Lumbee all wearing versions of the pine cone patchwork that Miss Maggie added, created for that quilt. And the tradition, this particular visual craft tradition, has been passed down for, many years, but in particular, it was taken up and kind of popularized by our ambassadors, by actually our actual queens. If queen was used as an insult for Rhoda, this particular group of women who serve our tribe in this way have completely refuted that stereotype. You know, they are actual queens. And they wear this pinecone patchwork at every possible occasion. The quilt is really all the evidence we need to understand that in Lumbee society, women are not here to serve men, and women cannot be held to a man's standard of what it means to be well-behaved. Miss Emily said it best. The quilt was something she was making and leaving for her people, a piece of history for us all that sheds light on 200 years of living history told by Native women. And for me personally, the quilt is more than a source to be analyzed. It provides me with guidance on how to live, on what my role is in my society, on how to be subversive by being a good relative and by fulfilling my responsibilities. Making history actually means making space for others. And if you want to see yourself in history, you won't forget history and you'll just start making it. Thank you.